I'm Philipp Meyer. I'm talking today about the SGS interface in OpenMSC. How do we go forward? Okay, yeah. Well, I'll start a bit with circuit switch fallback. What's the idea is behind it, and then I will talk a bit about the SGS interface and at the very end of it, of the implementation details, as we already have that feature in Osmo MSC, so there's an implementation. first of all, there is no CS domain in LTE, so LTE is a pure packet switch network, so it means we have no voice, no SMS. Of course, that's not entirely true. There's a substitute for that, which is called IMS, the IP multimedia system. And we have, I mean, you probably know that anyway, we have these voice over IT, these VoLT, which you also sometimes read in the newspapers. So commonly known, we have the SMS substitute RCS, it's the rich communication services. So basically, SMS is seen as a legacy service. Okay, but there's no reason to be upset about that. LTE has no CS domain. There's still circuit switch fallback. Basically circuit switch fallback. Also the IMS can be complemented with with circuit switch fallback via SGS, which basically means it doesn't. It's not a replacement. You can have both, but the advantage of doing CSFP is if you already have a 2G, 3G network available, which is the most common situation, is the case. You can skip the IMS. You don't need the IMS core and all the equipment behind it. You can reuse your existing circuit switched. Switching equipment and but of course that only works when you have the legacy networks available, and for circuit switched fallback calls you really need 2G 3G coverage, so there's some limitation to it. Quick recap on the idea. What we want to do is we have the 2G, 3G network on the one side and we have the LTE network on the other side. And we have the UE, which is registers with LTE. And since we have supposed we don't have no IMS core available and we want to do a circuit switch for SMS, it thinks it's simple. We can just use our 2G, 3G switching equipment and forward the SMS to LTE. That is a simplified picture, by the way. It's much more to it, but basically that's the idea. The SMS comes into the MSC, it gets processed and then just forwarded to LTE. For calls, so for SMS it's simple, since the UE can be all the time registered at the LTE RAN, so it doesn't have to fall back in that sense. For calls, things start to be a bit more difficult. So there we don't have these forwarding capabilities. So we really have to fall back the UE to the 3G or 2G RAT. So it really has to go to another RAT. And that's a bit more difficult. And the question is, how do we accomplish that? The UE is basically has to be basically registered in two networks at the same time, which is not possible RAT-wise, but in SGS we will see it's almost the case. It's the UE is known by the 2G network and by the LTE network. For SMS, the MSC VLR forwards, and for calls, we do the fallback. So basically, since this is a bit of a complex task, this requires additional signaling. And sehr vor, wie we have to add another interface, and that's the SGS interface, which brings us to the next topic. And yeah, what we see here is basically an LTE network and a 2G network, and we basically add the bridge between MME, which is the mobility management, and this is sort of an MSC in LTE. So we add a bridge between the two, and the bridge is right here between MME and MSC. And yeah, so basically there's a connection between the 2G network to the 3G network, MSC, and the MME, which is basically the role of the MSC and the LTE network. We don't have to, I will focus this talk more to the SGS interface and more to 2G, because the LTE infrastructure here is quite complex, but we have similarities. We have an HSS, HLR, the home subscriber server, that's the HLR in LTE basically, but here this is the serving the holding the subscriber database. And that's used by the two in Osmo MSC, when Osmo MSC is interfacing with LTE networks from different vendors, we have a kind of a problem here because we have Osmo HLR, and then the other vendor has a different HLR, which the two won't interface with each other, which is not a problem. So this means this can be one component, but it doesn't have to be. Yeah. So next one. So the SGS interface is specified in 3GPP TS2918, and it's basically very straightforward protocol. It's spoken over SCTP, and it consists of TLV messages, so it's really easy to implement, and there's no complex parsing like ASM1 involved there. And the MSC on the 2G, 3G side will take the server role here, so the MME will connect the MSC. Yeah, so basically the protocol carries only signaling information. For the SMS is an exception here, so it's usually signaling only, but SMS is also carried over SGS. That's the reason why we don't have to do a full fallback to the 3G 2G RUT. When we send an SMS, so that just gets forwarded through the SGS interface internally. But for voice, that's of course a different story. So that's there we really have to perform the fallback. And of course, the two parties, the MME and the MSC, they have to share some subscriber state. Basically, both parties need to know that the subscriber is currently available for CSFB, and that brings us to the state machine model that is specified by the SGS interface. So it basically consists of three states, basically an SGS null state, which basically means so there's no association at all, so the subscriber is not available for CSFB. We have the LA present state, which basically is this state machine also serves as a location update state machine in SGS, because there is a separate location update. We will come to that later. So the LA update present state basically means that the MME has initiated a location update via the SGS. So I think I have to elaborate this further. The the SGS interface on the MSC side is kind of another run to the MSC, but not quite. It's different. There are subtle differences to it, but basically you have to imagine that it is similar to what you have on the A interface. Location updates, service requests, stuff like that. And so it is for the SGS interface as well. So the MME will do a location update on the behalf of the subscriber that is registered with LTE on the MSC. But that's a simplified location update. It's not the complex state machine you have in 2G, 3G. So it's basically that what you see here, three states. The present is basically means that the location update is currently pending, and SGS associated means it's done. So the subscriber is associated via the SGS interface, and it's available for CSFB. So basically, when you end up in the SGS associated state, it basically means the subscriber is present in the VLR of the MSC. It's registered. It can, when SMS arrive at the MSC or calls, paging will occur. So it's basically a valid subscriber then, with the exception that it's not attached via 3G or 2G via A interface or something. It's attached via the SGS interface, so to say. And here are the transitions we have. It's not all transitions, so there's more to it. If you are interested, you can look it up yourself in chapter 4.2 from the CGPP spec. But that's it's the most important transitions here. So you can see there's the location update from the MME comes in. We end up in the present state. What happens there is the MSC will start to talk to the Osmo HLR, or basically to the HLR, check is the subscriber valid and create it. And when everything works well, the location update gets accepted. The MME, of course, gets informed about it, and you end up in this associated state. If the MME is for some reason doing another location update, you will end up again in the. I'm always showing something with the mouse here, which is not visible on the big screen, which is sad, but you get the point. I always try to avoid that, because if you record slides, it's better doing it with the mouse. But anyway, so basically, if should the MME decide to do another location update, you will end up in the LA update present state again, and basically, the things will start over. So to end up in the state null again, you either detach from the MME or you do a dual LU from 2G, 3G. So if the subscriber, for some reason, is registering on the normal way to the 2G network, again, CSCS association also get lost, of course. So basically, this means the important state here is to look at, is the subscriber associated or not, and if it's associated, you know it's available for CSFB, and you can page it. Paging happens through the SGS interface then, and travels up to the LTE, to the UE via the LTE RAT run. And page the subscriber basically from 2G up to the LTE. But we'll see, of course, later in the slides as well. So there are certain situations where you are forced to SGS null state. You can either get a reset from the MME, so basically when the MME restarts or for some reason state gets lost, you can receive a reset, and then you have to invalidate all the SGS associations of all subscribers associated with that MME. Of course, your VLR can fail. If your HLR fails, the VLR fails as well. That's the scheme we have in Osmo MSC at the moment. So if Osmo HLR dies, the VLR will fail as well. And then, of course, there will be a reset in the other direction. Paging may fail, or alert may fail. Alerting is not implemented at the moment in Osmo MSC. It's an optional feature. basically about subscriber monitoring. And yeah, basically, if you look up at the specs, you will see that paging is also mentioned as a transition for the state machine, but it's not changing the state. It's just keeps state set via omitted set here. Yeah, basically, this SGS state machine exists similar in the MME as well. So the MME is also maintaining an SGS association, of course, because it has to know as well, is subscriber, can I do CSFE or not? There are different procedures defined in the SGS specification, which are a bit fine-grained. I've broke that down to basically 5 points. Basically, we do locations updates, we do mobile originated and mobile terminated SMS, we do mobile terminated and in brackets MO CSFB calls, and attach and reset. So that's basically the five major topics I've dealt in the past while implementing that for Osmo MSC. And now things get a bit more exciting. We are looking at flowcharts. So this is the this pic depicts an SGS-based location update. So what we see here from the UE is on the LTE, that's still on the LTE side, the attach request, and then the attach procedure is carried out. It's a number of steps, and yeah, then we see that from the MME, an LU request is sent via the SGS interface to the MSC VLR, and then we carry out the location update on the SGS interface on the MSC side. Basically creates the SGS association. Technically, in Osmo MSC, it's the way that it's already created when a subscriber is created, but it's always created in state SGS null, of course. So basically, what that means for us is we go to LA present and carry out the state transitions. And yeah, we also see the map GSUB stuff that is when the MSC is talking to the HLR, to Osmo HLR. And if everything goes well, we get an LU accept back. So the MSC gets the LU location update accept. And then we are attached via SGS interface. So, and if the MSC needs some service, some SMS calls or so, it can page through the SGS interface. Then the UE gets notified. Can also look a bit further into the MessDrive Wireshark trace here carried out for you. The messaging model in SGS interface is more like it's not connection oriented. So we have messages, and the identification of a subscriber happens through the IMSI. So almost any message, except for reset, I think, and some it's basically the which are to the management of the SGS interface. But almost any message that's subscriber-related contains an IMSI, and that's how subscriber identified. There's also, of course, an MME name, which is a fully qualified domain name. That's basically what identifies the MME. So we get the location update request from the MME, and the MME is identifying itself. There's also VLR names. VLRs have also names, but in that case, it doesn't have to be a fully qualified domain name, but MMEs have to. And by that, the MSC is knowing which MME is talking to it. It's already carried out via the reset, so it recognizes it, the MME, and can follow on with the procedure. Basically, we get the attach in there, the request, and Then we accept it. So that's all. So it's not really elaborated. So that's why we also don't need a complex state machine here. So these three state machine is enough here. And then we get a TIMSC reallocation complete back from the MSC. So it allocates and set from the MSC 999 to, oh no, it's from the MME. Destination port is 29108. So now the SCS the subscriber is SCS associated. So the association is present. And by the way, there's usually a periodic location update timer that doesn't exist in SGS interface. So it's this timer is temporarily disabled. So we don't see temporary location updates there. Now we are ready for.
The reason why that timer isn't there is because there is a timer in the MME. So basically, the periodic location update timer that normally you start in the MSC. It doesn't need to be started because there is a similar timer in the MME and there is no need basically to have two timers running. And if the timer in the MME would ever expire, then it would basically send an, whatever is it, an IMSI detach or whatever over the SGS interface. So basically we outsource the timer to the MME.
I see, yeah. Thanks for clarifying that. As I said, my focus is mostly to the MSC side and basically I'm not so much aware what exactly happens in the MME. Now let's look at something more difficult. So that's a mobile originated SMS via SGS. So basically what happens here is that the UE is sending an SMS via SGS interface to the MSC, and the MSC is continuing on with CVC processing. So in SGS, we have something like unit data, which basically carries the SMS NAS messages. As far as the SGS interface is concerned, it doesn't look at that data. So when we pass the messages back and forth inside the Osmo MSC implementation, we don't really look at it. We don't even know that it's an SMS. So we basically pull the levers that would normally be pulled on the when an SMS transmitted via the A interface. So what we basically see is the UL NAS transport from the user equipment to the MME, and then it gets interesting. We see the uplink unit data and the SMS sendings, basically these few messages, CPACK, CP data, which are not depicted here, are forwarded. And in the very end of it, we see an SGS AP release request. That's basically when the whole process is over. So that's basically ending the connection. It's not really a connection-oriented protocol, but it has some message to say, so this is it's now done. Things get more difficult if you have a mobile terminated SMS, because then we need to page. So there we see at the very right, we see the SMSC wants to send an SMS. And the very first thing that's happening is it's a paging. And the paging then gets propagated to the UE via the LTE network. And then the service request is carried out. The service request is not the same kind of service request we see on the normal 2G network. It's more like a paging response. It also goes in the opposite direction. Basically, by the service request, we know that the UE has responded to the paging on the LTE side. And then we carry out the SMS handshake stuff. And at the very end, we terminate with the release request. Should there be an error in any of these SGS message passing and procedures, a status message would be sent by one of the sites. And basically, status is, if you see status, it you mean it basically means error, and it clears basically everything. I only, of course, cover only the good cases because errors never happen. So yeah, now things start to be get interesting because if the SMS sending and receiving is carried out via the SGS interface only, so that's simple. We just pass a few NAS messages back and forth without even looking at them, and basically the UE stays where it is. It stays in the LTE network, but for the mobile terminated call we see here, it has to actually change the network. So that's the real fallback. So that's the real circuit switched fallback case. And yeah, we see this call starts via the SIP invite, and as with the SMS, we would get a paging request, which is propagated through the user equipment, and basically on the LTE, we get the extended service request and stuff. And then we get a paging response from the UE to the BSS. And basically that ends up in a complete layer 3 message. So what we see here is above these first bubble there, we are still in the LTE network. So we get the service request from the MME, so that's via SGS interface, and we do the setup, this context setup, which is done by the MME, so it's not but something we see on the SGS interface, of course. Then the paging response from the UE comes in, but that paging response is already on 2G, so the basically, what we then see is on the A interface, we see the complete layer 3 and we do the call as we normally would do it.
Yeah, ah. So actually when on last light, when SMS is being sent, let's say, there's this paging, but actually the mobile phone doesn't jump to 2G, right?
No, it doesn't.
So what's exactly the difference that tells the MS to jump to 2G or just stay on 4G?
Yeah, that's some magic on the LTE network. Harald maybe can.
Let's repeat the question first. Yeah. So the question was: in case of the paging for mobile terminated SMS in CSFB, where the phone stays on the LTE radio carrier, what's the difference to the paging that happens in the CSFB case? I think the paging itself is not different, but what happens after the paging on the RRC layer of LTE is different, where then the MME either instructs the phone to do a circuit switched fallback, or where the MME basically then just stays on LTE and receives the NAS message with the SMS. So it's the on the RRC layer of the LTE protocol stack.
Okay, so we are actually missing some messages there, right? So that's the difference.
Well, we are only looking at those that are relevant for the SGS interface here. I mean, like when you look at a normal ladder diagram yeah, but if you look at a normal ladder, also you wouldn't put in like, oh, there was a RAT request, and you know, so you always reduce some level, you zoom out a little bit so you don't have, you know, every LAPDM retransmission and every RAT request and whatnot in there.
Yeah, okay, fine. I was just thinking like, okay, yeah, I didn't saw those messages there, so I just wondering like what was the difference. So yeah. Makes sense.
As far as the SGS interface is concerned, in the paging request we sent there, we would say we still have some information elements that say, oh, this is a paging, we want to do SMS, or we want to do a call now, so then the MME already knows what to do. Okay, yeah, while the call is carried on, the SCS association remains intact, so there wouldn't be any change to that. And there's something like, I think that's called fast fallback or something like this. So basically, when the clear command is issued via the A interface, there's a CSFB indication information element, which is only basically one byte at the identifier itself. So basically, if that is present, the RF channel release message would contain some flags to basically to do a cell selection after, it's a very lengthy name, after after release, I don't know. So there's basically some signaling involved to throw back the UE as fast as possible. But that's a detail. So let's look at really quick at the MO call as well. I first thought that I should exclude that, but because it's not not really SGS interface related, there's a lot of going on, a lot going on between MME and UE. But basically, as far as the MSC side, the 2G3G side is concerned, an MO call is basically looks and feels like a normal 2G call. Which is also obvious because there's no paging needed for that. It's basically the equivalent of a rush request on LTE, and then an LTE instructs a mobile phone to go to 2G and perform the call there. So there's not really anything we need to do on the MSC side. Basically comes for free. And then, yeah, finally, we also need to look at the detach, because that's a bit weird. So there are different detach situations, and I really had some difficulty to get that right in the beginning. A detach can be also, of course, be implicit or explicit. Implicit means UE is detached because some timer expired. Basically, it's gone for some reason. That doesn't make too much difference to the processing in an Osmo MSC, but there's an EPS detach and an IMSI detach. The EPS means Evolved Packet Core, Evolved Packet System. I don't know. That's basically LTE. So if you do an EPS detach, you basically say, "Oh, I want to detach from. I'm detached from LTE, but I want to be live on as a normal 3G 2G subscriber." So if we receive an EPS detach on the MSC, that basically would mean we would invalidate the SGS association, basically go to SGS null and thread the subscriber as it were a normal 2G subscriber. So a subscriber is not purged from the VLR. For IMSI detach, things are different. So that means it basically really means the subscriber is now detached from 2G, 3G, and it's gone then. Now we go through some implementation details. I already mentioned a lot of details, I think. But what we have here is basically I call it a two-territory implementation. Two territories because we have MSC and VLR in one process. I don't know if there's a split planned in the near future, but it would be theoretically possible. But the way it's designed in Osmo MSC is the VLR and MSC are kind of separate. The MSC side basically does all the the work in quotes. It handles the messaging, it does the parsing, and does all the action work. While the VLR is handling the subscriber only and does controls the location update, controls the SGS association, of course, and basically is responsible for the subscriber state ref counting and so on. So when integrating the SGS interface, I had to take care of that. I had to maintain this separation. And here's what I came up with. On the very left side, we have the IP network and the connection to the EPC. Basically, the EPC is the Evolved Packet Core, I mean the MME. That's where we got connected to. There's the SGS server C file, which is basically passing message buffers back and forth between SGS E-Phase C. And in SGS E-Phase, we have the MSC, basically the action, so basically what to do. I mean, if you need to page, we need to page. So it's this kind of stuff, initiated paging, triggering a location update, passing back and forth the NAS messages for the SMS, reacting on service requests, that's there. And we also have this little state machine I didn't talk about yet there, these null wait completers, that's for the reset. For the reset, we also have a little state machine inside there, which basically controls the reset at the very beginning when the MME is basically negotiating with the MSC, it has to carry out a reset procedure, and that's what I mean by that. Then we have a VTY, of course, which basically offers us some configuration, MME name and stuff, VLR name. Yeah, and then we have the boundary between the VLR and VLR and MSC side, and there I basically have I didn't reuse the location update FSM, which is already present in the VLR, because it's a very complex thing, and since the state machine for the SGS interface is very simple compared to that, I decided to basically put another state machine, it has another state machine next to it, and it's also specified in that way. You know the specification, it specifies the state machine for a reason, and it's used for location updates as well. And then, so basically we have this state machine, and then we have a VLR SGS C. So the VLR SGS C is our API, basically. So there, when we go from the MSC side and want to carry out some VLR-related action, we call a function in VLR SGSC, and then this function may issue a event to the state machine, and the state machine may perform some stuff. And basically, the way we get back results from the state machine is a callback function. So you would issue a callback function to when you issue a call to VLR SGS, you can issue callback functions and that are getting calls. That's, by the way, only necessary for location update, I think, because you somehow need to get notified if the location update is successful or if it failed, and there are callbacks for that, and these callbacks would generate the appropriate messages on the SGS interface, and execute that. The other way would be to call functions directly from SGS FSMC, the functions directly in SGS EFSC, but that would basically break the separation, so I didn't want that, so that's why I came up with this callback model there. Yeah, and basically, yeah, that's it now. We are through now. Are there questions?
You mentioned that the MME got to be identified by fully qualified domain name. Yeah. Why is that? Why can't we use just IP address? So how it works?
It's specified that way. I don't know what the exact reason is behind that, but it's in the specification. You have to use a fully qualified domain name there in the form that we've seen it in the trace.
So that's the way you tested it as well? You did not use IP address?
That's the way we tested it. By the way, testing. So when implementing this, we didn't have the chance to try that out on a real MME. So basically all the testing and the implementation testing is done via TTC and 3, and all the tests are designed by the specification. So basically this is not very much tested on real MMEs yet. There are some people out there who are currently testing it, but I think there are still some kinks in there which need to be ironed out. If you are interested in how traces would look like, you can always go to our Jenkins service and look at the TTC and 3 test artifacts. They would get traces of it, and yeah.
Yeah, I have one more question. I see in location update request message that we use location area identifier. This identifier of which location area? I'm trying to understand. Because it's MMBS sent this message to MSC.
I see. I must admit that I also do not know really what to do with it other than recording it.
Well, I think you need to configure on the LTE side which location area overlaps the tracking area that you're currently in. Because in the end, this should... So if you want to make sure that your phone can switch between... do cell reselection between 2G and 4G without doing location update and EPS attach, detach, and so on all the time, you need to have overlapping tracking area and location area.
So it's location area of 2G network, yeah?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So basically this means that if there is a... this location area you send and this location area is recorded on the MSC side. So if the phone switches to 2G and you have, I think, idle mode signaling reduction enabled, then you don't need to do a location area update on 2G because it's already stored that it currently is in that location area.
Well, just about the question was to how the phone knows to which ARFCN to go when a calls happen, and the more practical issue is that we are carrying some trials with 4G in Mexico, and I'm doing some simple lab testing at home with some open air interface derived MME and HSS. And also SRS, EPC, I ran, and they're in Node B. Like, do you know if any of them have this SG interface already in place?
No, unfortunately not.
So, no, there's no open source implementation of SGS on the MME side in none of the projects. And regarding the question of the ARFCN, we don't know and we don't care. It's the job of the LTE E-Node B to advertise GSM neighbor cell information in LTE system information blocks. And the phone autonomously chooses whatever ARFkin is listed within those neighbor cells with a strong signal on the right MCC, MNC.
Thank you.
So basically, you need to manually... actually, I have a presentation about LTE and Osmocom coming up, and that will look more at this in detail.
Super noob question. What is SG, lowercase s, in the context of...
Oh, yeah. I tried really hard to find out. I think it's service gateway. That's my guess.
You mean an SGW?
The SG. The SG and SGS.
No, it's just, it's like, what's the A in Avis?
What is the A in Avis?
Okay, that's interesting.
So in LTE we had the E node B, and in 5G it's called the G node B. Why is it called G node B? Somebody suggested to call it F node B, but it was refused in the meeting. So they went to the next letter. Okay, do we have more on-topic questions? No. Okay, then I think we can thank Philipp. Thanks.
Thanks.